No word from Francis Bruce. Well, they won't tell me. The hell with them. Ashtray, please, Andrew. Which camera? Good morning. Thank goodness the post office strike is over. On neither side, the government in its handling or CUPW in its leadership deserves the slightest credit. Well, maybe a little bit here and there, in my view. The whole thing has been a shambles, not just for the past 18 months of the contract troubles, but for many years now indeed. So what sent them back to work? We all saw and wondered fearfully about the open defiance of the laws of Parliament, the continued apparent counseling to continue the strike. And then suddenly when Lamontagne talked about the mass firings, things began to change a little bit, because you could see the basic fear in the leadership of the CUPW. There were two fears. One, the legislation prevented them from striking until the new Crown Corporation is brought into being in a year or so. So that, of course, made things very difficult. And the other fear was that with the mass firings, the membership of the union would not stand solidly behind CUPW. In fact, it kind of demonstrates to me, and I don't like to say this particularly, that CUPW and their strike votes did not properly represent the feelings of the inside postal workers themselves. But there was more to it than that. There undoubtedly was quiet but effective intervention from Broadbent, the leader of the NDP, who doesn't want to talk about it. Because how could the parliamentary leader of the New Democratic Party expect to achieve mass support in this country for his policies when one of the big labor unions was openly defying the rule of parliamentary law? So Broadbent exerted a lot of common sense pressure on them. And at the same time, of course, the Canadian Labor Congress was in exactly the same bind. How can they go for political solutions to things when we were on the verge, and let's not mess about with it, of what could have been a form of anarchy with incredible legal and social problems in the country? Let's hope that some or other sanity prevails on both sides, that the mediator arbitrator makes some sane solution and the postal system gets back to something like reasonably normal. So in that way, God bless them all. Now, by the way, what did happen to those Coney Island signs that we exposed in Lost Lagoon? Remember them? One of our listeners put us on to the problem of the Coney Island signs in Lost Lagoon. They were an abomination. They had $10,000 scheduled for these particular signs. After we exposed them, the signs have been put in storage, and I hope they haven't wasted the entire $10,000 on the signs. So it's a little nags from the public that keep these bureaucrats, somewhat tasteless they are in their views, in order. And while we're talking about bureaucrats and big projects, not just little projects. Let's take a little look at the waterfalls in Stanley Park, because we must keep you up to date with the troubles on Robson Square. When I did my report on Robson Square, there were the most beautiful waterfalls flowing all over the place. Remember the waterfall chapel, the lovely noise of the waterfalls? Everyone thought they were so beautiful, especially the wedding couples, but something went wrong. What went wrong? The waterfalls are too noisy, the desks vibrate, there are leakings, and you cannot now run the waterfalls. So what you see is a waterfall-less Robson Square. If and when they can fix it, I do not know. But it's another example of what happens to our money, and it's a shame that the waterfalls don't work, and maybe they'll never, ever work again. Now, in this morning's program, being Friday, we're going to have a little bit of fun, because I've got a spittoon expert, at least I'm the spittoon expert, I've got an art expert on the program this morning who cuts me into little pieces because of my fantasies about the value of my much-fabled spittoon collection. But we're going to start seriously this morning. We're going to start seriously with two experts on diabetes, juvenile and others. And we have two doctors here this morning who are going to tell us what's happening in the field of diabetes. In Diabetic Association. It's a symposium. Where is the symposium?
At the Century Plaza.
Mm-hmm. When?
Tomorrow morning, starting at 9.
Tomorrow morning in Vancouver, a symposium is being held, a public symposium on diabetes, particularly and specifically juvenile diabetes. And I have two doctors here this morning, Dr. John Clement, who is a researcher with the insulin division of Connaught Laboratories of Toronto, of course, and Dr. Claire Reynolds, who is the director of diabetic teaching at St. Paul's Hospital and a physician at that hospital. And I suppose my first question to you, doctor, because I'm a marginal diabetic, you know, I pretend to ignore it and I try to ignore it, but I suppose my first question to you should be, just tell me the latest research developments in diabetes, which one day in the future might stop the necessity of people having to jab needles into themselves each and every day of their lives.
Well, at the moment, as you know, Jack, a insulin-requiring diabetic does require a needle at least once a day to inject insulin into them, which the body is unable to make in quantities adequate to maintain proper control. There are some different aspects of research being carried out, some in Connaught, some across Canada and the universities and hospitals across the country and in other parts of the world. I would not say that in the immediate future or in the near foreseeable future there will be any way really to get away from the
diabetes. But I'm quite sure that in an authoritative medical journal, the Reader's Digest, or perhaps in a filler in the corner of a newspaper, I've seen something once about an artificial pancreas which would eliminate the need for so much fuss with diabetes for the individual.
Yes, and there are two or three different types of research that are going on in this field. One would involve a small device which would actually have the cells that produce insulin in the pancreas. These would be growing inside this device and the insulin would be able to come out from this and into the bloodstream.
What do you mean, a little package attached to
the
body?
A little package inside the body. But this is a long way in the future.
Surgically inside the body?
Yes.
With a little motor or something that fed
the... No motor. A biological pancreas replacement. This is a long way in the future, but this is one type of research that is being done. A number of problems exist. One would be the rejection problem. Mm-hmm. The body would recognize this as a foreign object and would want to get rid of it.
Is this the researcher's dream or is that just somebody's whim?
I think that it's something that is promising enough so that in perhaps a 10 to 20 year time span there may be something.
I'm going to talk to you in a minute about where the devil you get insulin, but first of all I want to talk to Dr. Claire Reynolds. Diabetes, you're going to talk tomorrow about the onset of diabetes in juveniles particularly? Is this something with which children can be born, or is it something which is acquired because of bad habits, environment, genetics, or what?
That's a very complicated question, Jack, but as far as
I ask the complicated questions, you answer them simply.
That's very good. I'll try that. It seems that as far as our current knowledge is concerned, one is born with the ability to develop diabetes, and it's probably something within the environment, whether it's nutritional or some toxic substance or a virus,
is
unknown.
When you say environment, I think of the air. You mean something else then?
There can be something else besides air. Anything within that one takes in after one's born could perhaps trigger off the diabetic condition.
You're saying there's a possibility somewhere along the line that diabetes is caused by a virus?
Yes, there's fairly clear evidence that a virus may be implicated in the cause of diabetes.
When does it show in young children, or is it easily identifiable?
In children, fortunately, it is easily identifiable because the symptoms are fairly clear-cut. And most cases of insulin-requiring diabetes occur before the age of 25.
Oh, yeah, we're not talking about babies then in this case.
No. It's rare to occur before, say, age 5. But fairly common then up to age 10, 15, 20, 25.
Well, before we get any phone calls, if we go to the phones in this morning, give me, and I know doctors don't like to do this, the extravagant symptoms of to a mother who's concerned about, say, a 10 or a 12-year-old who's exhibiting some unusual physical signs. What are the extravagant symptoms?
It's very easy to identify the extravagant symptoms, and these are drinking a lot of water and then passing a correspondingly large amount of urine. The appetite usually remains very good, but yet weight loss is very prominent. And it's in this type of setting that we recommend that a blood sugar or urine
sugar be
done.
Well, that's easy. A lot of water, a lot of urine, and weight loss despite the great gorging of food.
Excellent description.
Good. Insulin itself, I have never asked anyone. You manufacture insulin in a laboratory, do you?
No. Insulin is extracted from the pancreas of cows and pigs. And throughout Canada, the slaughterhouses which slaughter cows and pigs are extracting the pancreas and freezing it immediately after they take it out of the animal. Then it's trucked in a frozen state to Willowdale, Ontario, just north of Toronto. And there we extract it. Now, it takes something like 4.5 tons of pancreas to produce 1 pound of insulin. And 1 pound will do 600 diabetics for a year.
How many tons of animal pancreae? Pancreases?
Pancreata?
Thank you very much, doctor. Of animal pancreata. Can we produce enough in this country for the diabetics in the country?
We certainly can, and we are producing more than enough for the diabetic needs of
Every Canada. Time an animal is killed in a recognized inspected slaughterhouse, the pancreas is preserved instantly, fast frozen, and goes off to Willowdale to be turned into small quantities of insulin.
A very large proportion. We don't quite get all the pancreas, as there are some slaughterhouses which are perhaps too small for it to be to be feasible to collect these. However, we do get virtually all.
Is that why? Tell me about Connaught Laboratories, and I know you're not an expert on the price of insulin. You're a research associate. Do they have a monopoly on the production, properly so it would seem, of insulin in Canada?
We'd like to look at it the other way around and say that Connaught guarantees that, and Connaught is making production of insulin for Canada its number one priority, so that we do have a company within the country which guarantees that Canadians have first priority on all the insulin that can be produced from Canadian pancreas.
And so we should too, because was it not two Canadian doctors, or was it one Canadian doctor who discovered the insulin?
Well, Dr. Banting was a doctor at the time, and Dr. Best was a medical student who later became a doctor.
Do we have enough to export insulin to other people?
There is, at the moment, some capability to export.
Well, I'm going to talk some more about diabetes and Connaught Laboratories with Drs. Reynolds and Clement. Am I not right that at this moment, Dr. Clement, and he's from Connaught in Toronto, Dr. Clement, that in fact the techniques for individuals, despite all your research, are still the same as they were many years ago. Insulin in a wee bottle and a needle.
The basic concept is the same, that's quite correct. However, the insulin itself has improved greatly over the 58 years since it was first discovered.
You mean in quality or quantities needed or
quality,
what?
In quality, the quality is extremely high compared with the early extracts.
But the early extracts, were they not as effective?
They definitely did work, and the first person who received insulin was a young boy who was in diabetic coma at the time. He lived a number of years after that until finally he died in an a motorcycle accident. It was a traffic accident and so totally unrelated to his diabetic condition.
I wouldn't mind from either one of you a little bit of history, the discovery of it. How in the name of goodness did Banting come across this, Banting and Best? How did they do it? What put them on the track of the pancreas of animals to produce a magical substance which saves a little boy from death?
Hmm? Well,
do you want to handle it?
This was one step in a continuing series of experiments and research that had gone on throughout the world. And it was Dr. Banting who had the final inspiration that a particular way of extracting the pancreas might be able to get something out that would have this effect. Other people had tried the same sort of thing before, but they had not been able to get the insulin out without having it destroyed, mm-hmm. and it was therefore not effective when they tried to use it. It
wasn't quite as simple as the public folklore about, what was the name of the guy, Fleming and the mold and the penicillin.
Oh, no. This was a well-conceived experiment.
Scientific experiment.
It was conducted in a relatively short space of time in borrowed laboratories in the University of Toronto.
Mm-hmm. Now, I don't suppose that you can really manufacture the animal pancreata in a laboratory. Or are you going in that direction of research now? Because it would be an awful lot easier if you could, instead of all this animals and deep frozen and thousands of tons for small packages. Why can't you duplicate insulin in a laboratory?
You can. There are a number of ways to do it, but it's very much more expensive. And this, of course, makes it impractical for the average person. It is possible to take the beta cells out of the pancreas and to grow these in a tank and then to take the insulin from these. However, the cost of insulin would be extremely much higher as a result of this type of work than taking it from the pancreas where it is produced naturally.
Dr. Reynolds, you deal with diabetic children all the time, I presume.
Yes.
What's the ratio in the population of the problem with diabetes among children and among adults, too, for that matter?
Within the general population, probably about 2% of the population has got diabetes. Mm-hmm. A certain proportion of those require insulin, and another proportion can get by with the use of oral pill forms. And there are still another group which don't really require any treatment other than adherence to a fairly strict type of diet.
Don't look at me in that cold, withering way. What you're saying is that if one is a properly disciplined adult, that one can lose weight, never touch a drop of the spirit, get down to 126 miserable skinny pounds, and jog every day, dropping dead fit from a heart attack. Is that what you're saying to me?
That's possible for a large proportion of the diabetics.
Which I am probably one. But I don't know. I don't want to drop dead running around Stanley Park, even after they've taken these horrible signs down, I'll tell you that. Tell you what we're going to do now. We're going to go to the telephones and take some calls, from people. You'll probably get some very odd calls. You might get some very good calls, because I think you'll find that, am I right in thinking that today's parent is much better educated than, say, my generation?
I've seen a change even within the 10 to 12 years that I've been in medicine. There's been a tremendous change, and I think it's primarily because of the use of our diabetic day centers.
Oh, didn't know we had them.
Oh, yes, they're widespread across Canada. We have in excess of 100 now.
You're both speaking, by the way, for the Canadian Diabetic Association.
We are both members of the Canadian Diabetic
Association. You mean that people can take their children in the early stages to these daycare centers to get the proper balance of food and insulin?
Exactly, yes. And these are well available in many centers.
How many in BC?
I don't know the exact number. I would say in excess of 20.
Pretty good. Are they federal? Are they government things, or are they under the hospital scheme?
They are partly funded, as I understand, through the hospital scheme.
Okay, ready for questions? to Dr. Reynolds and to Dr. Clement on insulin. Diet. Going to go to the phones. You wanted to talk about you. You wanted your free
plan. No, actually, I'd already mentioned.
Mention it again.
Okay.
Your symposium tomorrow.
Yes.
Century Plaza.
Yeah.
Public invited.
Yes.
No charge.
There is a registration fee.
Oh, what's the registration fee?
$15, including lunch. Including
$15, including lunch. I'm glad you mentioned the $15. Go ahead, please.
I would like to speak to the doctor on insulin.
Yes, carry on.
My daughter is a juvenile diabetic, and she's taking Toronto and NPH. And when the insulin gets to the date, like say August 6, 78, can she use it as of August, or does it have to be thrown away?
The life of insulin, according to the date on the thing.
The date of the insulin vial is approximately 2 years. Well, it is 2 years from the date of manufacture and putting in the vial. And after this time, it is no longer current. It is, I would say that there would possibly be no real hazard in using it. However, I would recommend that one would use only current insulin.
In other words, it must be less than 2 years old.
Okay, the other
That's
thing
regulation.
Is, I have been told by two different doctors. One said it should be left in the refrigerator, and others say it doesn't matter.
Now, there's a good question.
Yes.
What's the answer?
Connaught, as the manufacturers, definitely recommend that it be stored in the refrigerator whenever possible, but without freezing. It's extremely important that it not be frozen, or the properties can change considerably.
Now, my daughter, if she takes it out of the refrigerator and she inserts it in her leg or her stomach, she said it's cold. So she leaves her daily dose out, but her emergency supply in the refrigerator should...
Is that a good practice?
No problems in allowing it to warm up, as long as it would not be placed in direct sunlight or on a hot radiator,
right,
or in another place where it can get hot. As well as freezing, it's important that we avoid too much heat on the insulin.
Thank you very much, and I'm sorry I can't go to that convention tomorrow.
Thank you.
Okay, bye-bye.
These are good questions. Go ahead, please.
Hi, I'd like to thank Dr. Reynolds for the daycare centers that they have on diabetes. I went to one, and I think it's great because you get more information there than your own doctor could possibly find time.
Is it your child who's the patient?
No, I am the patient.
I'm sorry. How old are you?
I am 26, or I was 26 when I became a diabetic, and I couldn't have children at the time. And when I did go on insulin, I got pregnant right away
Now there's one for you. If you had a diabetic under control, you have a much better chance of getting pregnant. Is that right, doctor?
That's not a recommended procedure just by taking insulin. Other things are necessary, I understand. Pregnancy just doesn't come from taking insulin.
But it may be part of a phenomenon in relation to the cure of the diabetes, or the control of the diabetes, doctor.
It may indeed, yes.
Thank you very much, ma'am.
Okay.
Go ahead, please.
Yes, good morning. I'd like to ask Dr. Reynolds a question, please. This is on the subject of diabetes. Could a young child, age 6, be diagnosed as Crohn's disease and possibly the parent thinks it's diabetic because of the same symptoms that you described of loss of weight, good appetite, so forth?
Okay, if I heard you correctly, you mentioned Crohn's disease versus diabetes. Yes, there are some similarities in the early presentation. However, Crohn's disease does not generally present with drinking a lot of water and passing a lot of urine. And so these two features would differentiate the two conditions.
In other words, there would be no confusion in the minds of the attending physician if he tested them for both factors.
Exactly.
Thank you. Go ahead, please.
Yes, Jack, I wanted to direct my comment to Dr. Clement. A friend of our son has diabetes, and he's about 4 years old, and his doctor was talking about a small thing that they put under the skin in the arm, which contains about a six-month supply of insulin. Now, I was just wondering how far they're going on that, or if they have it at all still.
That's for Dr. Pierce. Dr. Clement.
Clement.
I'm not on this morning, Doc.
Well, it's Friday.
Right, go on.
Yes, that is something else that I can talk a little bit about. At the moment, it's necessary to put insulin into a diabetic patient by inserting this by means of a syringe and a needle. However, research is going on, and we're associated to some degree with research that's going on at the Hospital for Sick Children in Toronto and in other centers across Canada and around the world, in which small pumps are being manufactured and tried out for use, especially in special cases of diabetes, where there may be a problem in controlling the condition as well as in most people. Such studies involve a little pump and a supply of insulin, which is then pumped into the patient at the proper times, a little faster, a little more concentrated at meal times, of course, because this is when the peak requirement for insulin does occur. It's going to be a while in the future.
You're not talking about an implant now.
I am talking about a little pump. Some of these pumps are in the form of an implant. Some of them are in the form of a maybe a small purse that could be strapped under the arm, a shoulder holster type thing. I wouldn't see these in the immediate future. However, I have seen experimental units in use in Toronto, and this is very interesting work, and it does hold some promise for better control.
That would be for patients who are in a particularly difficult situation. The needle would obviously be much better for the average insulin patient in the present stage of development.
For the average patient, the needle has worked well over the 57 years and continues to do so.
Thank you. Go ahead, please. Where are you? Come on now.
Morning.
You were there a moment ago. Do speak up. That's you.
Yes.
You just said good morning. Where is she, Linda? I don't want to miss it. I'm talking to you. You said good morning.
My husband has a brown diabetes.
What's that? What's that?
I don't know.
Hold on, ma'am. We'll talk to you off the air. Go ahead from Prince George. Hello.
I'm from Smithers.
Smithers. Go ahead from Smithers.
Hi. I've heard that potential diabetics and diabetics have very large babies. If you have diabetes in your family, and have a large baby, could this be a sign that you may develop diabetes?
Yes, indeed, it could. And one of the remarkable things we find in some adult-type diabetics or maturity-onset diabetics is that going back through the history, which may extend 20 or 30 years prior to the time of diabetes presenting, we will find that there is a history of large babies in excess of 9 or 10 pounds. And this may, if taken as a future sign, be an indicator that diabetes will develop in the future.
Oh, you've put the fear of the Lord into hundreds of people. In many good old Scotch families, a big baby is the healthiest baby, it's the smartest baby, it's got the biggest head. And you doctors have stopped starving pregnant mothers again, haven't you?
Yes, we have.
But you're saying that a history of big babies in the family might put one on the, what's the word, the key V?
On the alert.
On the alert.
For diabetes developing later on.
Later on.
Yes. Mm-hmm. But this is usually not the insulin-taking type of diabetes that develops later on.
I see. No snarky remarks about me either. Thank you. Go ahead, Dave, from Prince George.
Yeah, good morning, Jack.
Yes.
I'd like to solicit an opinion from your two guests in regards to...
Well, if you'll hold on a second, you can solicit the opinion in a couple of minutes. Don't go away. Where is Fort St. James?
No.
Where are we now?
Okay, we're right here. For your phones, you will have 6 minutes and 40 seconds, yeah. And by then you should be into your film, because this is a self.
Okay, that's fine.
Okay.
I understand now.
Okay, so I count you into when you have
to. You count me into that.
I count you into that. Okay.
I'm going to, so therefore I'll. Don't come back to me after the cows.
Oh, you want to go straight? Okay.
Okay, so we're getting a count to cows now, are we?
Sorry, yeah. You should come back after cows to set up McKay.
How long?
Okay, I'll come back. Right. So we got 6 more minutes, gentlemen. I'll take the long distance ones now. Prince George first, and then? You're going to have to write them, love. I can't hear you when you go. I'm too far away this morning.
Or maybe 6:40 it's me. To cows.
You're 6:40 to my intro for cows. Just you sit while I do the intro. I'll thank you, nod, and go to the camera. There's always a great interest in questions to experts like yourself about a common condition like diabetes. And this is Dr. Clay Reynolds from St. Paul's, and this is Dr. John Clement from Connaught Laboratories in Toronto. And the man from Prince George wanted to put a couple of points to you. Go ahead, please.
Yeah, I'd just like to get their opinion on Dr. Atkins' diet revolution. It's a very low carbohydrate diet that I went on about 3 years ago, and it's extremely effective. And he claims that it controls all sorts of triglyceride levels, and it's an excellent combatant against sugar in the blood, high sugar levels.
Okay, that's one good question. What's your next one?
That's it. That's
okay. Good question. Do these low carbohydrate diets, Atkins or otherwise, actually help people to beat the onset of diabetes in adult life?
I'm not sure that they actually prevent the onset of diabetes, but it is true that if one adheres to a very low carbohydrate diet, then there is improvement in some of the biochemical things, such as the blood sugar and the triglycerides. The whole concept of the Atkins diet has not, however, been substantiated by any widespread clinical trials, and the books that have been published don't have data in them which can be subjected to scientific.
Is there any of these so-called popular diets which a diabetic, some types of diabetics could go to for diet control of the condition? Any popular ones, or do you recommend only the hospital type diet?
Because of the time-honored safety of the diets that we recommend through the Canadian Diabetic Association, the American Diabetic Association in the U.S., we don't think that we should use fad diets when we have safe and effective diets with proven ingredients, proven amounts of vitamins and trace minerals such as iron, etc.
Yeah, some of these odd diets have been accused of causing some bad conditions, have they not?
Yes, and some of them have resulted in death.
Yeah, they're like the drinking man diet. You carry that to extreme and you'll kill yourself. Go ahead from Fort St. James.
Yes, this is Mrs. Creighton from Fort St. James.
Yes.
I'm 59 years old and I've just discovered that I have diabetes. And I understand that they have pills that they give for these kinds.
Well, now, if you've just discovered, what has your doctor told you? What has your doctor recommended for you?
Sometimes dangerous to people with heart conditions.
Oh, yes. Remember that study, the RNAs, or the equivalent of it thereof, in certain testing groups were supposed to. Let me ask the doctor, love. I know the point. What do you say to that?
Well, there is still divided opinion on whether that study should be considered valid or not. Personally, I accept the results of that study, and I use the oral pills with great discretion. And generally, if a person who requires some form of treatment, such as insulin or the pills, I will try to convince the individual to take insulin. If this is absolutely impossible for social conditions or other conditions, then the pills are acceptable. I'm now recommending that every 2 years, the actual need for that pill be reviewed by the doctor who prescribes the pills.
So you're saying to follow your doctor's advice?
Follow your doctor's advice, and particularly.
But the pills.
Go ahead.
But the pills are no good for people with a heart condition, I understand.
The pills, it is true, should be avoided in those who already have.
Oh, the pills should be avoided for those who already have a heart condition.
That is correct.
But if you don't have a heart condition, then the needle is not needed.
You also didn't say that one of the one of the symptoms also of diabetics is your eyes. And this is how I found out there was something wrong.
Well, we haven't gone into the full clinical symptoms of diabetes, have we, Doctor?
That's correct.
Thank you very much for the very good call, ma'am. Go ahead, please.
Yes, Mr. Webster?
Yes, sir.
I've got a question and a few answers. For the first part, I'd like to give you a brief history.
Of whom?
This is directed to Dr. Clements.
Yes.
The wife was in the hospital off and on for a period of years before they even detected diabetes.
How long ago was this, sir?
This was, in a period of 10 years. She's been off and on in the hospital. They couldn't find out whether it was diabetes or epilepsy that was causing the problem.
Well, I'm afraid we can't go into the particular medical diagnosis. So the object of the exercise this morning, sir, which has been quite successful, was that Dr. Clement would tell us about some of the research discoveries, and Dr. Reynolds would tell us about the symposium tomorrow in Vancouver at the Century Plaza on the juvenile diabetes. So I can't, you can see for obvious reasons, well, I don't want to cut you off. I can't go into a long, complex medical history of your wife with diabetes over 10 years. One minute to go. Go ahead, please.
Hello?
Yes.
Yes. I'm a diabetic, and I'm on pills. But listening to the doctors, it sort of reinforces my attitude that there's a link up somehow between mumps and diabetic.
Is there, doctor? Is there? Is that a nonsensical question?
It's not at all nonsensical.
Oh.
Some patients who have juvenile-type diabetes can have antibodies to the mumps virus in their blood. It's not yet established whether that is a coincidence or whether mumps is one of the viruses that can trigger diabetes, but it's a valid line of research.
Thank you very much indeed. I'm grateful to your presence here this morning, Dr. Clement, and yours too, and I hope your symposium at the Century Plaza goes well tomorrow. And no more nasty remarks about my appearance off camera either, Dr. Clement. I have another little piece of business I must do here before we come up to something else. Now, it's cattle against people in the residential neighborhood of Langley District. Residents along 248 streets are mobilizing their forces to move on Langley District Council on Monday. Their concerns, a large feedlot that has gone up in their neighborhood and the noise and smell that goes with it.
Jack, this is one of two feeder barns to go up in this very small chunk of property. The second one will go up just behind me here, right next to the church. The people here are complaining about the noise. Imagine the competition for the church choir on Sunday morning.
At the center of the dispute, 150 head of cattle and more on the way. The concerns of the people around them, the dreadful whining noise that goes on all night, and the manure that will pile up and create a smell so horrible, they say, it'll foul the pure Fraser Valley air. Owners of the feedlot moved the cattle onto the property in the early hours of the morning a couple of days ago. The people who feel powerless in their efforts to halt the maneuver have mobilized forces. It's people against cattle, their concerns, noise, smell, and property value.
We can hear the noise, and I'm sure we'll smell them come summer too, and we're hoping to have a pool. And if we ever sell, we know our property will go down.
We're downwind, and already we've smelt them, heard them. Next summer, we won't be able to live in our backyards.
It's rats and flies, you know. And when you got open feed like that, it's nothing but rats.
Just taking the value of our property down all around our community here. We're all small lot holders.
The council has again ignored the wishes of many taxpayers for the sake of one particular individual.
The council hasn't even given us a chance to rebuke their decision. That's all I've got to say. I'm disgusted with the council.
The feedlot is on land zoned agricultural. The properties in the immediate surroundings, small residential acreages, the hobby farm variety. Public approval was not needed to allow the feedlot to go ahead. Owner John Dakin wants to fatten his cattle and ship them off to the packers in March. Despite the complaints of a noisy, smelly winter, the lot will stay.
Good old Brian. That report was by Brian Coxford. It's the kind of local thing we'll do every now and again just to let you know what's happening. Next, we're going to talk about these. I have the world's best collection. I think you're lying and blind. I'm blind and lying. Brand new cabinet, isn't it?
Oh, do you remind me to take a video?
With Brian on camera.
Yes, he was.
Yeah.
No, yes, it was.
Funny thing happened to me on the way to the station this morning. I was rummaging through the basement. You know, I'm a junk collector, a pack rat. And I came up with this very unusual egg cup. Funny thing, isn't it? Bit stained too. Looks like a matter of fact, it would take a peacock egg. And I found this little silver gewgaw, which must have belonged to one of our wealthier great grannies. And I found a whole lot more junk too. I don't know what the devil that is, unless maybe it's a mustard thing. But I called an expert on the subject and I said to him, "Sir, will you value these items for me, please, one at a time? First of all, would you identify this gracious, delicate porcelain thing?"
Yes, Jack, that is a Chinese wine cup used in the religious ceremonies in China, and it dates from the late 16th century. It's a Ming period piece.
In other words, if I threw this away, I'd be in real trouble.
You'd be throwing away about $700.
That's a Ming piece.
That's a Ming piece, yeah.
And you mustn't use it as an egg cup.
No, to drink out of it.
What is that, precisely?
That is a salt cellar without its liner.
Without the liner. Everybody's got these.
Yes. Well, I don't think everybody has them quite like that.
That's... What kind of salt cellar is that?
That was made by Richard Hennell in London in 1781.
It's... What's it worth?
It's part of a set of four. It's worth $1,500.
You mean the four are worth $1,500?
Yeah.
18th century.
Individually, it'd be worth about $200.
About $200, without the insert.
Well, the inserts are packed separately.
What is that?
That is a mustard pot, again, without its liner.
I was right. Yeah. It's a mustard pot. Okay, I want to go
that,
to these.
That was made by an English, famous English silversmith, Hester Bateman.
Hester Bateman. Man or woman?
Woman.
Woman, Hester Bateman.
The queen of the English silversmiths.
It's a woman.
No.
Queen of the English silversmiths. Right now. I want to get rid of these. Who are you? Will you give me 700 for that? 200 for that? And how much for that?
No, I won't give you that personally, but I can arrange the sale in our London or New York auction rooms.
How much do you give me for that and the sale in the New York auction room according to your expert valuation?
$750 to $1,000.
$750 to $1,000? Are you here in a plea for people to go through their basements so that you can take their stuff away and sell it for them in New York and London?
Absolutely, yes.
What firm are you associated with?
Christie, Manson & Woods.
Christie's?
Better known as Christie's, yes.
Oh, yeah, they're almost as big as Sotheby's.
Almost, yes.
Which is the bigger firm?
Sotheby's is the bigger
firm. Sotheby's is the bigger firm. You're not English.
We're number two. We try harder.
You're not English, are you?
No, I'm Scots.
You're Scotch. Don't give me this Edinburgh jazz about being Scots. You're Scotch.
Well, we won't get in that argument.
Right. Are you an auctioneer or a
valuator? No, I'm not an auctioneer. I'm an appraiser, and I represent Christie's for Western Canada.
You're an appraiser. I want you to appraise something for me. Are you ready for a shock? We'll put these valuable items to the side. How much will you give me for Lawrence of Arabia's water jug?
How do you know it belongs to Lawrence of Arabia?
Because I bought it in a man Jordan, and every piece of junk I buy, I make stories up about them.
I see.
And my grandchildren will be convinced that this was Lawrence of Arabia's water jug, and there's no way that you can't prove it wasn't Lawrence of Arabia's water jug.
Can you prove that it was?
Well, it was around at his time. And it was in a junk shop in Amman. It was made in the early 19th century. It's turned. That's turned.
That's turned, yeah.
But it's hand-beaten. And to me, it has a certain ineffable grace and delight. Would you not agree?
Yes, it has a primitive charm about it.
I don't like the way you say that so snobbishly, a primitive charm about it.
It's not snobbishly. We refer to artifacts like that as being primitive.
Oh, this is an artifact. Yeah. That's what you call it.
That's what I call it, yeah.
It's not an object of art.
It's not
an
object of art, no.
It's junk.
Oh, it's not junk. It's...
Do you see that? Do you know what that is? That is a knife fastened from a file by an inmate of the BC Penitentiary who in 1963 planned to kill me with it. Yeah. Is that an antique or is that
me? I thought it was perhaps your ski and do.
My ski and do. That happened to be inside there. Now I'm going to show you an object of art. And for this I want, if I'm going to send this to Christie's, what must the basic value be before you look at something to ship it to London or New York to be auctioned?
We don't like to, well, in our overall operation, we sell more items for less than $250 than we sell over $250.
We're in business. What's that?
It's a charcoal burner.
What is that? Sir, what is that? That's a beautiful object of art, hand-worked in brass, solid brass, which itself is worth about $2 a pound today.
Yes.
And it is a Russian cuspidor. The Russians, when they spat, were very genteel about it.
Oh, I see that.
They have lids on the cuspidor.
It looks like a brazier, a table brazier.
You mean to say, sir, you do not recognize that as a spittoon?
No, I don't.
Are you daring to contradict me?
I'm not contradicting you. You're a noted collector of spittoons.
Is that an object of art, or is that more Webster junk?
It's not an object of art. It's, again, what we would call an artifact.
But it's beautiful.
Of course, it comes into the...
Look at the symmetry and grace of that.
It's beautiful. It comes into the category of decorative items.
A decorative item. And you wouldn't ship this to Burnaby, or from Burnaby to Vancouver, less.
Oh, if you wanted to sell your whole collection, we could ship it and feature the Jack Webster cuspidor collection.
I prefer the Jack Webster spittoon collection.
Well, it would be just a question of semantics with our catalogue.
As I prefer to say Scotch instead of Scottish. My wife was throwing these out today.
Why, don't you eat asparagus?
Is that what this is for?
That's an asparagus tongs, yeah.
You mean I take the asparagus like this and put it in my mouth like that?
No, that's just to take it off the serving plate.
What's a serving plate? That is early English silver, is it?
Yeah, it's George II silver.
Ah, worth a pretty penny.
$400.
Sterling silver. Maker's mark on it. And these?
That is, most of that's Edinburgh silver you've got there. That's typical George III, George IV silver, which we sell a great deal.
But everybody, what makes it so valuable?
The makers and the age.
It's funny, that, isn't it? Everybody thinks the whole they have. Show me something nice about it.
Well, this one was made in Edinburgh by Alexander Henderson. Unless you can...
Not old Sandy Henderson. Was it Sandy Henderson that made that? Is that his mark? Well, I'm really quite interested in your operation. Is this something new for Christie's?
To have a representative here?
Yeah, and to ship the stuff there.
Well, there's a lot of stuff goes here from Christie's, to Christie's, I beg your pardon. I approached Christie's 6 months ago with a suggestion that they might have a permanent representative here. And after a lot of correspondence and 2 weeks in New York where I was more or less examined as to my own knowledge, I was appointed their representative.
Uh-huh. How much commission do you charge on it? I mean, when it gets, what must the Christie
10%.
Charge? 10%.
And Sotheby's average, 22%.
That's a cheap shot. They probably get much more than you do.
10%. Christie's have no extra charges in the 10%.
No extra charges. What is this thing here?
That's a Scottish 19th century genre painting. I brought it along, I thought you'd be interested.
What kind of painting?
Genre.
Who is genre?
It's a school of painting that depicts everyday life. This is by a Scottish painter called Walter Geikie.
Walter?
Geikie.
Geikie. And genre, is that a Scotch word?
No, it's an English word. It refers to a style of painting.
How do you spell it?
G-E-N-R-E.
Genre. Yeah. It is a French word.
What's also
genre,
an English word?
A type of painting. How much is that worth?
About $600.
Would you believe it? People would pay $600
for it. I paid $80
for
it.
Oh, you paid $80 for it?
Yeah.
You got it from an old blind woman in Oak Bay in Victoria.
No, I bought it in the Maynard's auction room.
You bought it in the Maynard's auction room? And it's
about
worth
5 years ago. And I just sent a photograph to Christie's and they said I'd get about $600 for it.
That's great stuff. Absolutely.
Well, 19th century paintings going up in value more rapidly than any painting
to me,
at the moment.
It looks as if the frame's worth more than the painting. Is that a wooden frame?
That's a wooden frame.
Well, put that out of the way. That's most unimpressive, even for $600. I've got more artifacts for you. Just one more.
Chestnut roaster.
Is that not lovely?
Yes.
Eh? Did you ever see a nicer small chestnut roaster? Matter of fact, my granny used to use that as a warming pan with a wee bit of charcoal on the bottom of it and do the, you know, the wet sheets in Scotland.
Mm-hmm. Where the wee damp sheets.
damp sheets. But that's nothing. You throw that in the garbage.
No, we would collect stuff like that until we had enough of it, then we'd make a sale out of it.
Make a sale of it. Well, you've shattered all my illusions. But you'll value it, sell it, take 10% off it. But you want big fancy stuff out of big fancy houses.
Not necessarily. Mm-hmm. I've got a lot of stuff that's turned up in the last 2 weeks. That's going to New York. None of it necessarily very valuable. We have some very valuable stuff going.
Okay, one last thing I'm going to illustrate to, I think it's this camera over here. There's a picture of a chair here. Can that be seen? That can be seen. And I'm talking about, where's my glasses? Excuse me, messy. One of a pair of Queen Anne Walnut side chairs, American stuff. How much did it sell for?
$176,000, a world record price for a piece of American furniture.
Where was it sold?
In Christie's, New York, last Saturday.
For two chairs?
For two chairs, yeah.
That's unreal.
I believe it is unreal too, but you know, dollars, money's worth nothing now.
It doesn't make it, so therefore the thing to do is to invest in
people
antiques.
People are buying costly antiques.
So therefore people shouldn't sell their antiques, they should keep them.
Some of them need ready cash.
And these are the ones you want?
Yeah, the ones I want. Well, we pay in American dollars.
You pay in American dollars, yeah. Comes back that way. And you've had your plug, this is my plug. Thank you very much, Mardu McKay of Christie's. Cheers.
Yeah, so
do you know that for sure?
Yes.
That's
Roger
official.
Told me, yeah.
Who told you?
Roger.
Mr. Webster will be 11 o'clock on the
11th. Yeah,
on News Hour Final with Pamela, 11 o'clock Sunday night. Keep it short then, Linda. Tell me that, isn't it? Linda, what's next week?
Monday we have Herman Kahn of the Hudson Institute, and Tuesday Dave Barrett.
Dave Barrett Tuesday. That's Monday, right. Herman Kahn of the Hudson
Institute,
Think Tank. Big
Tank.
Noise.
Yeah.
Best of Webster is not 6:30 this Sunday night. It's with Pamela, God bless her, on the 11 o'clock News Hour Final. Don't miss it. Monday morning, 9 a.m.